Thank you so much, everyone. Let's get started. And the proceeding begins, everyone. So the Senate has begun the screening of ministerial nominees sent to them by President Muhammadu Buhari. The upper chamber had amended his rule and postponed his recess to screen the list of 43 nominees. The first nominee screened was Dr. Uchechukwu Oga, who responded to questions on the oil and gas sector, banking, and economy. Senator George Akume, Olorunbe Mamura, and Senator Gosweah Fabio were not questioned as the Senate maintained its tradition of allowing former National Assembly lawmakers as well as anybody who has served in the House of Assembly also, in the case of Rotimi Amaegi, to just take a bow when they are nominated for ministerial positions. Some ministerial nominees spent time to respond to questions from the Senate. Well, you heard some of them when we went on that break. Let's get talking. I have joining me some very critical and very analytical panel tonight on the program. I have Mr. Ken Okolugbo. He's a political scientist. Mr. Curtis Adigba is a political strategist and a lawyer. Thank you so much for coming on tonight.
It's always my pleasure, Shim.
From our Abuja studio is Honorable Wesley Dao, sir. He's a policy and governance expert and a lawyer, former member of the House of Representatives. Thank you so much for coming on tonight. Well,
Thank you very much.
I guess we should begin with how the process of today went. Let me begin with you. Are you impressed with what you saw today, the screening? Incidentally, the Prime Minister of the United Kingdom was confirmed today, Boris Johnson, and there was a proceeding there. The whole world was watching alongside what was happening in Nigeria's parliament. So from that perspective, the activities of what happened today, are you impressed?
Well, I think it's not about whether I'm impressed or not impressed. You just say they kept the tradition of the Senate. It's screening ministers. So it's not about whether I'm impressed, but I wish they had done it differently, you know, because the world is a global village. You see these things done in other places. I would have loved to see the nominees go to the Senate with a portfolio. Then we have the committee of the Senate, you know, drill them on specific issues. And this tradition that, look, once you have been in the National Assembly, to take a bow and go is not doing us any good, really. I watched their section, you know, who was the Attorney General of the United States. Jeff was the Senate for over a decade. And once he was nominated, he had to go through a proper screening, you know, from the committee and then to the general section of the Senate where he was confirmed. And the purpose of this confirmation is not just for you to show up and for us to see you on the screen. It's for the senators to go deep down and ask you questions that might be agitating the minds of Nigerians. So I think it should be done much, much better than what we have seen.
Mr. Okolugbo, your thoughts about today's proceeding?
Well, first of all, I was a bit shocked to see that members of the House of Assembly would now be actually ranked in terms of when they nominated ministers. I know there is the rule for the Senate and there's a rule for the House of Reps, and members of the House of Assembly are not ranked. But so to say, I think Uche Oga did very well. You can't take it away from him. My take on Akume is he's been a governor for 8 years. He's been a senator for 12 years. What do we do to the youth in Benue? Are we saying that they don't have any chance at all? I mean,
what do you looking, also do with
looking,
experience?
No, looking at like the fact that we are coming from Benue that was just represented by Awudu Ogbe, and now we have an Akume. That means we're telling the youth that you don't have any chance.
And personally, Mr. Adigba is from that part of the country.
I'm looking at it from the perspective, Shehu, that the president assured the youth, in which the president's wife, Aisha, was the deputy chairman of the Committee of the Youths and the Women, and Mara was their chairman. He assured them that they were going to have a place in his government, the youths and the women. And looking at all the ministerial nominees, I don't see any youth in that nomination apart from maybe Oga. Oga did very well. Don't get me wrong.
There's Emeka Nwojuba.
I don't have a problem with that. I think Emeka Nwojuba was great.
There's a woman also
because,
from Zamfara.
Well, if you look at Emeka Nwojuba's nomination, you see a bit of sentiments there. He ran for the governorship election in 2011 under the CPC. And the president has told us he needs to know these people. But looking at it holistically, that traditional bar and go is great. But look at, it's great for those who were members of the Senate. But looking at Rotimi Amaechi, even if he was a member of the Senate, I would expect Rotimi Amaechi to have answered a few questions. Today, we don't know how much we are indebted to in China Exim Bank. If it's returned back to the Ministry of Transport, we needed to ask some certain questions, especially about the Ibadan and the Lagos road track. I mean, sorry, rail track. How much are we indebted to the China Exim Bank? How much have we paid? What is the lifespan of that project? So many things are being shrouded in a bit of secrecy that he would have been forced to talk about them today. And today, when he didn't say anything, I think I took a little bit of an exception to that. Yeah.
Let me allow someone who has been in that in the parliament, Honorable West Idahosa. A lot of comments from Nigerians as to the concept of the bow and go. Is it good for this kind of process when we needed to know the quality of those who are going to be members of cabinet? Is it good?
Well, I think, Chef, thanks for having me here. But I am of the opinion that we should have moved away from the concept of bow and go at this point in time. And do not forget that we are in a dire strait. The country's economy is not as robust as we want it to be. There's insecurity. There's extraordinary times. So when there are extraordinary times, we have to do extraordinary things. I expect in the least that all of those who have been ministers before now, whether they were in the Senate before or in the House of Reps, should have given some account of their tenure in getting justification for their reappointment. So it is my hope that this should shift, and I hope that the 10th Senate, put it that way, will learn from the complaints of the public at this time.
Again, Ms. Adigba did mention something, attaching portfolio to the nomination. Could that have helped? Are you disappointed? Because a lot of people also criticized that process, the same process the last time, because some of the senators, especially from the minority parties, were not happy because they wanted to be able to grill some of the nominees based on their competencies and the offices or portfolios they might be overseeing. But that didn't happen.
Yeah, but I think that's the modern practice these days. You have to attach portfolio. And I'm surprised that we are still doing the same thing over and over again and expect to get new results. I think that by now, how do you get to screen these people accurately and adequately when you do not even know who is going where and who is coming where? I think that that's part of the improvement that the screening process should include in this innovation package, like we have seen in many other countries.
Well, I mean, let me put you right on the spot. The 43 men, the Buhari Next Agenda team that he has put together, he did that over 50 days. Now that we know them, now some of them are answering questions on what they can do and their capabilities. Are you impressed?
Well, you see, a few of them have distinguished themselves by what they have said to the Senate. But by the performance of some of those that are coming back, I am not impressed. And then by the profile of some of those that are coming, both on moral grounds and lack of performance history, I am not impressed. I do hope that they don't occupy sensitive ministries. And in many civilized climes, they won't pass the screening of the Senate. No question about that.
Why are you not impressed, Mr. Idahosa?
Well, if you look at some of those who are nominated, take the FCT minister, for example. What is the basis for his renomination? I mean, the city is almost in paralysis. Why would you appoint such a man who is unable to run a modern city? And then if you look at some of those who have had huge corruption history, who have had even cases charged to court, what signal are you sending to the public and to the entire world in your quest for corruption? This is a government that has corruption, security, and economy as its trump card. You cannot tell the world that you are fighting corruption if you have men who have had move up from one court to another for huge corruption charges, making your list and sitting in the same cabinet with you, the chief author of the fight against corruption. It doesn't make sense to me.
Mr. Adigba, you strategize professionally for politicians. You sit down and you try to draw up how politicians
leaders need to go. With what you have seen today, are you proud of the list of people? Some people have criticized and said, this is somewhat a payback kind of scenario that we have seen in some of the lists. Those who have lost out somehow, some way or the other, they have been paid back for their loss or something. That is politically how some people have read into the list that we have seen today.
You know, politics all over the world is compensatory in nature. Okay, you. And the process for nominating minister is a political process. It's not a technocratic process, like some are saying to us. And that does not mean that you cannot have a politician who is also a technocrat. You see, appointing ministers, for me, is like all Nigerians are playing the role of a president. You know, we sit down and in our heads, we have our list of possible ministers. And so when those names are not on the list, we are disappointed. You understand? And that's normal. But the fact is that this president was elected to govern. He sold a vision to Nigerians and said, look, this is what I'm coming to do. And I think in his mind, he has assembled a team that could translate that vision into reality for him. And he has the prerogative to do so. But that doesn't stop us from saying, okay, we think this is a good fit. This is not a good fit. And that's exactly what we are doing here. So, for those who are saying this is about job for the boys, I think in other words, that's what you are saying. It's not about quality. I don't agree entirely with them, but I also do see a sense in.
I think there's a deep quality in this thing.
I think there's quality. I wouldn't say deep, but I think there's quality.
If you pick a few personalities, which of them would you say you can go anywhere in the world and you can be proud of? That these are ministers. Members of Nigeria's cabinet.
I could go anywhere with Fashola. I could. I think people must understand that they had a very difficult assignment the last 4 years. And if you ask me, I think he did well. Okay. I also go anywhere with Amechi. I will. I mean.
The quality character
you,
too?
Look, you can't. This is not about character. You know, governance is not about character. And if you begin to use character as the only metric, how many Nigerians will be fit for public employment?
I mean, if you look
if character
at
is the only metric.
Yeah, if you look at some of the critical of offices and portfolios, for example, power, the economy, the minister for the office of the attorney general, that's in fact your one area that you should have interest because you are of the legal practice. Who amidst all of this? We have a few senior advocates. Fashola is there. We have Keyamo is there. We have Malami there, senior advocate. We have a few other lawyers there. Who comes to your mind that could be a perfect fit for that office?
I wish I was Mr. President, and I could tell you right away who would be my choice.
Who would
if I had to make a choice, I probably would go for Festus Keyamo, because I want to see some real activities in that area.
Do you agree with him?
Of course, I'm going to agree with him. First of all, it's even shocking that Malami was renominated.
Why?
Why would I say this? Malami was enshrined in so much controversies. Remember the Nolle Prosequi he filed on the case of Saleh, the registrar of the Supreme Court, over a $2.2 billion naira charge. Remember the fact that he's facing the legal privilege committee today that can strip him of his SANship because of the fact that he played a very noble role in the issue of Dasuki. Yes, that is it. That's a fact.
Allegedly. I'm not aware of that.
I am aware that he faced the panel. You can Google, you can check that. And again, you can also understand that when initially Babatunde was first indicted, I give you a lot of credit in this studio. You did a lot in the terms of Babatunde's story. Malami sat in the first panel that exonerated Babatunde. It wasn't until he was now made a member of the panel that the vice president now became the chairman of the committee, which was when Babatunde was then indicted. So if you have such a nominee from Kebbi State back from Mr. President, it's quite disappointing. Festus Keyamo has distinguished himself, not because I'm from Delta State. He's in the opposition, and I will always take on him any time, and I'll say, look, we're not members of maybe the same party. We don't believe in the same, maybe, political ideology.
But we are from the same state.
And I'm happy with Festus Keyamo's nomination. I won't lie.
And his nominee is young.
I won't lie that I'm happy.
He said mine is old.
I won't happy with the fact that I will betray my bias here. I'm very happy with his nomination. But
you think
if you make someone like Festus Keamo the Attorney General and Minister of Justice, if you notice what he did in May 2015, he recused himself from representing the EFCC in the case against Timi Presilvia. He said because his interest was not going to allow him pursue that case how he was going to pursue the case. And that is a mark of principle for
me. There is a perception a lot of people have criticized. Maybe I can go to Honorable Wesley also on this one. There is a perception that there are court orders that have been not been obeyed by this government. There are people who have been asked to be released from prison or from by the court, but they are not being obeyed. In that perception, and the call for a reform within the judiciary, who would be your choice? Would it be if, for example, you had a president?
Well, you know, the chief law officer of the federation is a key appointment for any president. You have a number of senior advocates that are very, very, very solid. Keamo is one of them. Fashola is also one of them. Malami is also there to an extent. So I think that between the first two, Keamo or Fashola, either of them will cut the mark as attorney general. And it is my hope also that we need a courageous attorney general and a compassionate one to the law who will encourage the compliance, who will encourage compliance with the law, saying that democracy is founded on the rule of law. So once you are not complying with the law, you are not promoting democracy at all. You are indeed endangering it.
So quickly, before we go on this break, I need your intervention. Would you return Fashola to power? Would you return Amechi to transport? But Fashola is power, works it out.
Are you talking to me?
Yes, Honorable Wesley Dawson. Quickly, that's in about 30 seconds. Would you return those two guys?
Yes.
Would you return Fashola to power?
Yeah, Fashola, if you were the president. I think Fashola will go back to power. Fashola should go back to power and wherever he is. Amechi, I'm not quite sure.
There are also some very important portfolios that we need to look at. And perhaps some of the quality that some of the nominees from President Buhari are bringing to the table, a lot of people will also tell you that in terms of communication, in terms of driving the idea of government to bear to the citizen is also very important. So they are very critical. I hope that we'll be able to show our viewers we highlighted some of the critical portfolios that will be very important. Power, works, the economy. Those are some of the critical portfolio. The minister, whoever becomes the minister of defense, and also the minister of petroleum. Those are some other critical portfolios. For example, the person that will be spokesperson of government, who would you think should be in that office?
There are two people that I can think of in the cabinet right now. Not in the cabinet, among the nominees. I'll be looking at Sunday Diary, who I think is a journalist and very well grounded in that area, to be able to serve the government or the programs of the government. And then the incumbent, in quote, Lai Mohammed, who is also...
Don't lie.
Do you agree with that?
The thing about what I've noticed about Buhari, he seems to be stuck on some certain people. You remember on this program, I should be giving some credit, I gave almost 98% prediction 4 years ago of what the cabinet was going to be. But I can't even read through the mindset of Buhari, why I read through his mindset 4 years ago to give that prediction. Because I think he's stuck on Lai Mohammed, so he's going to give him back information. I would rather have gone with him on the issue of Sunday Diary. But what I see from the service chiefs, we've been shouting about the service chiefs here, and he's stuck on the service chiefs. So when you bring back a Lai back to the cabinet, and remember that he has not explained to us why he brought back the six ministers. Remember, the Amejoda committee actually recommended that there should be a streamline of ministries, which is why you have power, works, and housing under Fashola. And so maybe because of the exigencies of the moment, he had no choice. There are two ministers from Kwara. You have Saraki and you have Lai. There are two ministers from Edo. You have Agba. And you have the other...
Enakire.
Enakire, the minister of state. Yeah. There are two ministers from Bauchi. There are two ministers from Kano and so on. So those six ministries,
he should have at least explained to Nigerians that I now have my hands are tied. I'm not going with what Ahmed Joda told me. He has not told us he has departed from the Ahmed Joda's report, which brought him into power. And he said he was going to stick to it, which was why he had 36 ministers. And so what I'm saying here is because the ministries are such now that you have 42 ministers, is no more the 36 that he came on board with. So certainly, if Fashola will not be going back to Power, Works and Housing, there certainly has to be a break in Power, Works and Housing. Maybe they'll give him Works and Housing and they'll give power to someone else. But I see him maybe taking someone like Uche Oga to power. That is what I see him.
Or petroleum.
No, he might not give him petroleum. He might decide to give it to the uncommon governor. Since he's the one in charge of the Ministry of Petroleum. Since he's a substantive minister of petroleum, he might want to give it to the uncommon governor if he doesn't give him Niger Delta. Then again, when you look at it holistically speaking, we're looking at those that can deliver. I agree that Amici should go back to transport because he has started a track that you can't stop. He's gone into a lot of contracts, he's gone into a lot of commitments that he has to see through. And so there's no two ways about it. We know he's going to go back to transport. But Hadi Sarike, from Katsina is going to go back to aviation. Setim is going to go back to aviation. Zainab is going to go back to finance.
Zainab will go to finance?
That is Setim.
I don't think. Well, I don't know.
We don't know the mind of the president.
We don't know.
But okay, so let's look at this. Some of those whose names were left out. Interestingly, a lot of people have said they never thought that Adambaza would be left out and Ibe Kachiku would be left out. If my producer goes back to the earlier graphic of those who were left out, the class of 2015 and 2019, those who did not make the cut. Are you surprised? Let me go to Honorable Wesley Dawosa. Honorable Wesley Dawosa, for those who were left out, are you surprised? What are the surprises that you have on that list?
Well, I'm not surprised. A number of them had no business in the cabinet in the first place. I can't quite remember any spectacular minister of the 2015 class that was left out. It clearly shows you that even the names that I remember that managed to do something are all part of those who returned. So it means that with respect to those who were left out, not many had much to be considered.
So, but if you look at those who have returned, and we're looking at the critical areas, the economy, power, works, the petroleum ministry, finance ministry, security, these are critical areas. What comes to your mind? What will make you think that this government, that the president is very serious about his agenda when he pitches some of these personalities and these portfolios?
Well, one can't be too sure about this government. The truth is that the president has a mandate and he's trying as much as he could to run it the way he thinks is best for the nation. In my own opinion, the only thing that should count for him right now, looking at the list of nominees, will be experience. And those who have experience or cognate experience at this moment are those who probably who have occupied some critical portfolios. So it might do him a lot of good to let those gentlemen and women continue with that portfolio, with the exception, in my own humble opinion, maybe of the FCT. Maybe they need to jiggle that a bit and see whether they can get a more up-to-date person with the paradigm shift going on with capital building nationwide. You know.
Let me get your final thoughts, everyone, on the program before we go tonight. And it's going to be what the president says he wants to do. He said he's next level. Isn't that enough body language to tell you where he will go and perhaps what he will do in the coming days as to the kind of people that he has now and how he's pitching them? Mr. Adigba, what are your general thoughts on this government, his agenda, and the crop of people that are going to be in the cabinet?
Well, first of all, I'll ask a question. If I was surprised that some people were left out, I had expected to see Kachoko back in the game, Ibe Kachoko, petroleum resources. I also expected to see Enelama, the industry guy, and Thomas.
But again,
you know, there are interplay of forces. It could be some not wanting to come back, and then the political calculations in their
in their states or within the party also didn't favor some of that. But look, the fact is, like we said, it's the prerogative of Mr. President to assemble a cabinet. It feels that the people that he has named are the best for him to do that. And when you look at them, really, like Mr. Dahosa said, he's got experience there. You have about four two-term governors, former governor of Akwa Ibom, a former governor of Benue State, Akume, a two-term governor,
Lagos.
Former governor of Lagos,
Lagos, yeah,
and then former governor of, what's the fourth one?
No,
now?
He doesn't have two terms. Ngige is
one. I counted four of them. Two-term governors, who are...
Aregbesola is...
Aregbesola, yes.
Some of the prominent newcomers now. So these are some of the people... Yes. I wanted to ask you, are you surprised with Benny Sola Saraki?
No, I'm not. And that's it's because you know what happened in Kwara State. She was in a different political party from the brother. And they were the architect of the Otoge that swept away the president of the Senate. So you couldn't have done otherwise. I think she also can be appointed because in her own class, she has got her own quality. Don't forget she was in the Senate.
Mm. Yeah, she was. She was in the Senate before the brother. So your thought, Mr. Okolibo, your final...
Well, I think someone like Sharon Ekiazo was brought to become the Minister of Women Affairs, having been the woman leader of the CPC. But to me, what I actually expect the president to do now is we have a very serious security situation at hand. I'm happy Ali didn't come back, the Minister of Defense.
Dan Ali,
yes. I'm very happy about that. And I don't hide the fact that I'm happy about that. Just the same way I've always said all the service chiefs should be kicked out, the same way Dan Ali has gone with the wind. What we expect him to do is to make a chief of defense, the Minister of Defense, that'll be alive to the responsibility of what we're facing. If you have the Oba of Benin, the Oni of Ife, the Alafin of Oyo, all calling out the president to say, look, we have a very serious crisis in our areas. Strangers are taking over our forest. People are being kidnapped on a daily basis. Mm. Call your people to order. That should tell the president that, look, we have a lot of crisis in our hands. Mm. So for me, apart from all the portfolios where we have talked about now, the key portfolio should be who would man the Ministry of Defense.
Mm. That would be interesting. Your final word, Honorable Wesley Dahosa, what will give you a feeling that this government is serious?
Well, the results, that's all. When we get the results, then we assume that they are serious. Without that, it will just be all talk and no walk.
Well, the eyes have it. And that's the proceeding for today from my chamber here at the Politics Today Studio.
Thank you so much.
From the former lawmaker to the political strategist and the political scientist. It's been a very analytical, very interesting conversation tonight. I must sincerely thank all of you for coming. Honorable Wesley Dahosa, thank you for coming. And Mr. Curtis Adigba, thank you. And Mr.
Pleasure.
Ken Okolibo,
it's always my pleasure.
And whatever you may be watching, either on your mobile phone or on your tablet, or you're at home watching, or you're at work, or you're in transit, thank you so much for watching. Do connect with the conversation. Tomorrow again, we'll be live for you with some of the remaining of the screening of the minister. That's all we have for you tonight. I'm sure. Bye-bye.